Peter Strzok, welcome to the Daily Social Distancing Show.
Thanks so much for having me. It's good to be here.
So you've written a book that even today is being name-checked by the President of the United States, Donald J. Trump. He's not your biggest fan, and clearly by your book, you are not a fan of his. In many ways, for him, you are the face of the deep state that he constantly talks about. Why did you write the book, and what do you hope the book is meant to achieve?
So the reason I wrote the book was to talk about the counterintelligence threat that Donald Trump poses to this day. Why in the FBI in 2016, we were so very concerned about his relationship with the government of Russia, and not just his, but all the people around him. And to point out to the reader that that threat, that problem didn't stop in 2016. Obviously, Director Mueller kept going, and the problem, in fact, stays till this day. And so I wanted to shine a light on that.
There's no denying that your role in this investigation and your role in the Donald Trump Russia saga has definitely been marred by, you know, text messages that the public has seen of yours, your opinions on Hillary Clinton and your opinions on Donald Trump. Do you think that you're the right person to say to the public, here I am shining a light, when Donald Trump will use you as the example of the deep state?
Yeah, I sure do. And here's why. In the first place, every FBI agent, most every government employee has opinions. I have them. Everybody I worked with did. And we talk about those in private. But the point is that every single day, all of us set that aside when we go to work. And part of what has been so corrosive about all this whole idea of having a deep state is, in my experience, that's absolutely false. And then the second thing I'd point to, because I understand people might have concerns, is this has been looked at up and down and left and right. There have been two inspector general investigations. There have been multiple U.S. attorneys, all kinds of congressional committees looking at it. And all of them have found at the end of the day that me and everybody else, that our actions were free of political bias or any sort of improper consideration, and that we were doing the right thing for the right reasons.
I don't believe in a deep state. I'm not a big conspiracy theory person in any way, shape, or form, but I do understand how it may look to somebody, especially a Trump voter, when Peter Strzok has emails saying we need to stop this person. And then more importantly, recently, an FBI lawyer was found to be doctoring documents. Once somebody is forging a document to go with their bias, I mean, that shows you that people don't just leave their opinions at the door, doesn't it?
Right. But when you look at what happened to him, I mean, he is paying a severe, severe price for his penalty. There is no room in the FBI ever for any falsehood, for any doctoring evidence. And when you do that, you're going to be held accountable. And that's exactly what you saw. To the broader point of, I understand how people might look at this and say, well, he had pretty strong opinions. But then let's go back to 2016. There were things that I knew and others knew and still knew to this day that if we had let it out, it would have really, really damaged Trump's campaign. Never happened. Let's also look at what happened with all the speech that Director Comey gave about Secretary Clinton,
But wait. If I may interrupt you there, let's take a step back. You see, so I feel like that statement you've just made presents the veneer of impartiality, because if you have something that you can't release on Donald Trump, that the public, if they knew about Donald Trump, wouldn't vote for him, but you can't use that, then why even tell the people about that?
Well, because there's a lie being made. There's a false accusation that Pete Strzok is biased. And so if I'm going to defend against that, I need to be able to say, hey, that's not true. And you say, well, show me evidence. And so the evidence is, hey, the things we did in the fall unequivocally hurt Secretary Clinton. They absolutely, by not saying something, they helped Donald Trump. Now, there's been all kinds of things that have been declassified by this administration. Unsurprisingly, a lot of those have been very, very favorable to President Trump. I can't decide, and it wouldn't be appropriate to. But if I'm challenged to prove my impartiality, the way I have to do that is to present the evidence of what exists. And some of that is known now, right? We know what Director Mueller found. We know all these people that he prosecuted. That's right. The sort of thing I'm talking about. We knew that in the fall. Everybody knows it now. But if we were to talk about all those cases, all those people that pled guilty to us about hiding their contacts with the Russians, that would have been very damaging. And of course, the United States and everybody can see the truth of what we knew at the time.
I've always been fascinated by how in American history, you always read these stories of how the FBI was surveilling or even interfering in the actions of protesters. I mean, everybody from Jane Fonda to Martin Luther King Jr. When you look at the protests that are happening today, would you say that protesters need to be wary of the FBI looking into or interfering in their lives? Or is that something that changed over time? Or does it just depend on who is running the FBI?
I think it's always something to be aware of. Look, I think the FBI is bound by regulation and a tradition of respecting civil liberties, but that came at a heavy price. As you pointed out, there were extraordinary abuses throughout the 70s, which culminated in the church and Pike committees, things like oversight reform that really codified ways that would prevent the FBI from behaving that way. And that began and became absorbed in the FBI's culture, which exists today. So I'm not worried about the FBI overstepping. What I do worry about is when you see some of these other actors, various entities within the Department of Homeland Security and other elements who don't have a traditional sort of domestic, you know, investigative role, who are being thrust into situations where they don't have a background, a traditional mission, or rules and regulations to monitor and constrain that activity. Everybody may be trying to do the right thing, but if you don't have that sort of regulation, the same sort of oversight, there's a lot of risk there. And so I'm also concerned that Congress has an oversight role, but there's been a tremendous amount of tension right now between the executive branch and Congress and that oversight. So I think that's a valid concern. I think that's something everybody should be looking at and making sure that we are behaving, I say we, that the government is behaving in a way that the American people expect based on our past dialogue.
You have now had quite the journey, you know, in and out of law enforcement. What would you change if you could go back? What are the things that you look back at as an agent and say, man, that's where I didn't do the right thing, or I didn't do it in the right way, and I should have done that differently?
Well, obviously, first and foremost, I wish I never would have sent the damn text that I did. I mean, that's the obvious, easy answer. But I think going back, it's a great question. I wish that we would have had a better idea of what was going on with social media and the vulnerabilities that presented before we did. We saw on the terrorism side that people like Anwar al-Awlaki were using YouTube to really good effect in reaching into the homeland and radicalizing people without any sort of formal meetings. And while we appreciated that was a tough terrorism problem, none of us, not me, not anybody else, said, well, wow, what if the Russians started using YouTube, Twitter, Facebook, to start doing the same thing, but instead of trying to recruit somebody to a terrorist organization, what if they were trying to use it to persuade people or plant disinformation? And of course, that's exactly what they did. So I wish we would have seen that sooner. I think we're getting up to speed now, but you know, that's the biggest thing that that I'd point to.
Your book is really interesting. Your journey is one of the craziest in American history. And because there's still investigations and Donald Trump is still president, I guess the saga will continue. Peter Strzok, thank you so much for joining me on the show.
Trevor, great to be here. Thank you.